serving because we know how blessed we are. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Up this morning, you didn't have to do it. We thank you, God, for getting us through another week. You didn't have to do that. We thank you for letting your son fall on that cross for the forgiveness of our sins. And also, God, we just thank you for loving us the way you do. I'd like to ask you to repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I thank you for loving me the way you do. I thank you for caring for me. Bless me. Bless me. Bless me. Make me a blessing. Make me a blessing. Amen. Amen. Yes.
It's now time for our altar call. We ask each of you to stand. We ask those who will to come down around the altar. This morning, you know every heart, every need, every care this morning. And Father, as we pray that you would just meet every need. Father, someone may have sickness in their home. Someone may not be feeling well themselves this morning, dear God. Someone may have financial problems. Someone may have a child that won't act right. Maybe a husband that won't act right this morning. But Father, whatever it is, we know that you're able to meet that need. And as we pray this morning, we ask that you would just be with each one in a special way. Father, that you bless each home that is represented here. Father, as we pray, we realize that we need you in the home, dear God. We need you in the our jobs, Father. We need you in our church.
Yes, sir.
Pray. We pray this morning that you would just be with us in a special way. That you be with each one, dear God, each individual. We know you can bless us collectively, but Father, we know that you can also meet every need. Pray that you just be with each one in a special way. Dear God, as we pray, we especially remember those that are not feeling well. Father, we know that there are those that hospitalized, those that may be in a nursing home, Father. Those that may be at home, dear God, we know that you're able to meet that need. Pray that you would give them the healing that they need, Father, that you would just have their way in their lives. And dear God, let them know. Just let them know that you're in charge and that you're able to meet their need. Father, we thank you so much for those that you blessed to make the trip through the hospital and back home, dear God, and pray that you would continue to be with them. Continue, Father, to bless in a special way. We thank you so much for we bless Brother Bristol, dear God, and pray that you would be with him. Continue to keep him in your care. Father, we pray this morning that you would bless our church.
Yes.
Continue, Father, to be with Friendship. We thank you for the distance you brought us, dear God, and,
yes,
and we know that you're able to see us through.
Oh, yes.
Father, we pray that you will continue to be with us, continue to keep us. Keep us together, we ask in the name of Jesus. Bless our pastor, dear God. Yes. We thank you for him this morning. We thank you, dear God, for the many years that he's been with us. The way you blessed him, Father, the way you have used him in not only Friendship, but in Johnson City, in the community, dear God, in the district, in the state. And Father, we pray that you would just continue to be with him. Continue to keep him in your care. We ask in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Pray this morning, dear God, that you would bless America.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we pray that you would bless everyone that's in a leadership position.
Yes.
Father, bless them. Bless them, Father, spiritually. Pray that you would bless them, dear God, with the wisdom, the knowledge, dear God, to lead these your people in a way that you'd have us to go.
Yes, yes.
Dear God, just be with us in a special way. We don't know, dear God, what's ahead. We don't know about tomorrow. But, Father, we know that you know, and not only that, we know that it's in your hands and that you're able to handle it. Father, again, we just thank you. We thank you, dear God, for everything that you've given us, everything that you've done for us, Father, for just who you are in our lives this morning. Pray that you continue to be with us. Continue, dear God, to just keep us in your care. We can't make it without you. Pray that you would just keep us in your care, Father. We ask in the name of Jesus and for his sake.
Standing and turn to selection 420, or you'll see on the canvas. Lift him up. Yes.
Jesus,
and I, if I be lifted up, world is hungry for the living bread. Lift the Savior up for them to see. Trust him and do not doubt the words that he said. I'll draw all men unto me. Lift him up. Lift him up. Feel he speaks from eternity. And I, be lifted up from the earth, draw all men unto me. Don't exalt the preacher.
Don't exalt the preacher.
Till he speaks from eternity. And if I be lifted up from earth, draw all men unto me. Lift him up by living as a Christian ought. Let the world in you the Savior see. Then men will gladly follow him who once taught.
Thank you.
That's a new member. Glad to have her. I can't believe she's grown that much. Okay, this morning we're going to talk about sharing God's love. So I have a question. Without God in our lives, do you think our hearts are full or empty?
Empty.
They're empty because we don't have the love of God in our heart. So the way that we get the love of God into our heart is that we have to accept Jesus. Is that right? You have to accept Jesus as your Savior, and He's going to fill our hearts up. Now, there are other people and other hearts in the world that do not have the love of Jesus. They're empty, like you just said. So God wants us to share that love with others. So I'm going to kind of demonstrate to you a little bit how to do that. Now I want you to look at this water. This water is going to represent God. And what do I have here on this paper towel?
Two love kiss.
Two love kiss. Okay, that's one way you can look at it. What do I have here?
A heart.
Okay, I got two hearts. And one is
empty.
And what's the other one look like?
One is full.
It's one is full. And what's it full of, Jason?
The love of God.
Love.
It's full of love. So remember, our whole goal this morning is that we want to share God's love with others. So the heart that's empty, we're going to share it by putting it in with God. So let's see what's going to happen. What's happening? It's filling up, isn't it? So the heart that was full, which is our hearts, filled up the heart that was empty with God's love. Now, the only way you can do that is that you have to be soaked in God's love, okay? But we can't do it by ourselves. We have to have the strength of the Lord to share that love with everybody, okay? So y'all have a good day and share your love with someone, okay? Amen.
Something, wasn't it? Oh, for grace. And it isn't by nothing else. It's unmerited, definitely unmerited. We want to think, as we think about the challenges that we face in life, we think about the difficulties, the problems, the things that we face that are more just touching and seem to tear you apart. And then God delivers you. See, that's the thing. That's the thing. And we want to look at a text this morning that to me is powerful, and yet there is a strong and wonderful uniqueness about it. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ. God's and our guilt. God and our guilt. Now, you may be saying, what? Why are you saying that? I don't know. It's not my sermon, it's God's. And I'm not jiving you. This is not something I'm saying to be cute, because this is real. He gave it to me in the middle of the week. God is astounding. God is absolutely astounding. I look at this thing, I think about when Saul became Paul. That's still, in the book of Acts, that's still a powerful and powerful thing. Walking on the Damascus Road, going to kill Christians, going to take them into captivity and then kill them. And he was a determined man to destroy the people of God, to destroy this cause that they're about, this thing of this Jesus thing. And he hit a change, didn't he? I'm so glad. I don't know about you. I'm so glad that one day in my own life, God turned me around. And I've just started to walk at his urging, the pathway he said walk. Did I do it just, oh, hallelujah, fantastic? I ain't gonna lie to you. No, I didn't want to do it. I tried not to. But he kept on saying it. And it wasn't repetitiveness that got it. It was that third phrase, that phrase. And all I'd given, you know, I'd given excuses for things and God would wipe them out. I said, Lord, I can't do that. Preachers that can't eat but just certain food. That was back in the time when Alston's were popular. And I had them good, both sides, left and right. And what happened was, I really meant that, because I said, you go to people's house and they say, I can't eat that, I can't eat that, I can't do that. And he said, where is it hurting you? Now, you may not believe this, you don't have to. And he knew where it was hurting. I said, it's my stomach. He said, okay, touch it. It left. I said, God, it's gone. He said, yes. I was played football in high school and got stomped. I played center, and I was a little guy playing center. And a guy jumped up on me in a practice session and stomped me in the lower abdomen. It didn't take but one lick, and I was almost out. Coach came and he said, don't get up yet, just wait. And he stood there, and one of the coaches prayed for me. He said, touch it. I touched it, the pain went away. Then my one that I just knew would work. I said, God, you know, I have bad back, and how can I, sitting in front of people or going long drives and all that. He said, touch it. Where is it? I reached back in my lower back, and the pain left. And I said, but God, I don't want to be a preacher. And it's, nothing came out. I heard nothing inside me until he said, in that still small voice. I love the film Charlton Heston did on about the Exodus, because that's what he sounded like. And he said, I said, but God, I don't you understand? I thought that was stupid. I said, God, but I don't want to do this. I quit rock music and I'm a gospel singer now. I can reach a lot of people that way. He said, well, you'll either do what I say or I'll make a vegetable out of you. That's all you, that's what you're going to be. I don't care what you say, you're going to be. This is your last chance, last day for help. And I paused. And if I ever made foolish statements in my life, that was the most smartest one I ever made. I said, yes, sir. Yes, I'll do it, I'll do it. You may be looking at this on the web, you may be listening on the radio, you may be sitting in here, and you're saying that sounds just like a fairy tale. I don't care what you think. I never turned back from it. This God we serve, when you look at what he offers and look at how little you have to offer, you realize that all my help comes from him. All the things that were worth anything came from him, because I don't have anything else going for me. It's grace, it's a gift, it's a present to me. And then you can tell the world when somebody tells you, I'll tell you what, boy, I'll tell you, you really got that going on. You say, well, thank you. It's, well, you, I tell you, I know you do, you something, man, ain't me. Not about me, it's about the Lord. This is Saul, who is now Paul. Saul of Tarsus, who is now Paul. And Paul is going in and going to do a ministry. And I think what is so powerful, look what he's telling us. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. He was separated from the rest of them and said, this is how you're going to be. You're going to do this. Doesn't matter what anybody else does. You are going to be mine. And in Acts 1:15, and in those days with Peter, that same thing happened. He says, in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples. And what I'm saying, what happened to him was he was singled out. If God was choosing somebody among your friends and acquaintances, would he choose you to say, this is what I want? Or would he know that you were going to have to do it? I don't know about you. Sometimes people say, well, I do what I just have to. God and our guilt. I don't care what it is. We, and I'm going to say it like folks used to say it years ago, we ain't got nothing to brag about. We ain't got nothing to brag about. We are blessed. We are blessed day by day, moment by moment. We are blessed more than you can imagine. You don't even know how blessed you are. Hallelujah. You don't know. Sometimes you start saying, well, you know, I'm just so glad this happened to me. And deep in your heart, you're saying, thank you, God. Thank you for blessing me. It's a blessing. No, Peter was singled out. Paul, both were singled out. And they made great strides in the cause of Christ. I don't know about you. But let me tell you something. It's a good feeling. It's not a cocky feeling. I'm not talking about that. It's a good feeling to know that you're doing what God said. Amen. And I'm going to tell you something about God. Don't lie on it. You know something? There are people standing in pulpits in this world, in this country right now, who shouldn't be there. Because you didn't call them God. You didn't call them. They know it. I had a guy tell me one time when I was called to preach. I knew you smart enough to get in this hustle. This what? I knew you. I didn't ever say anything to him about that. He just, somebody told him that, because we knew each other for a few years. And he said, man, that ministry, that's a good hustle. I said, no, it's not. No, it's not. It's my pastor. Thank God for him. He's already told me about people like you. He said, the burden is absolutely unjust. You can't imagine. You can't imagine this. Just, but if you keep on moving for the Lord, keep on standing up for the cause, keep on doing what God wants, God will bless you. You might say, well, I won't have no trouble. No, you're going to have trouble in this world. You're going to have it. But Jesus will bless you. And what he'll do for you is he will overcome those things for you. I'm so glad. I don't know about you. But and the other thing is, you know, we come off and say, don't anybody tell me what I'm going to do. Yes? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. God is in charge. The devil will tell you a lot of stuff you know. And the devil will give you strong arguments for a whole lot of stuff that ain't right. Do what God says. Let me tell you something else, too. If it's not in here, it ain't right. I don't care who said it. I don't care who said it. I don't care how smart they are. As a young minister, when I would go to conventions, my pastor would take me with him, and he would always give me a hint on certain people. Now, this fellow's this way, this or this. He said, because you don't you dare do what he says, because I know him. I said, well, what's he thinking about? He said, he's not thinking. He said, but I tell you one thing, he's trying to play a game with God, and it's not going to work. One of the things that gets us to it, we're not careful, is we need to pause somewhere along the way and say, wait a minute, I'm going to do this because God said it. And let me tell you something, and as I say, he will not. He will not do a thing against his cause. Too often what we do is we fix up our own way. And I'm going to tell you something. Just because you differ with someone doesn't mean they're bad people. It doesn't mean that. It simply means that you differ. But God is going to call the clay down. God's going to set it up. God's going to call it down to where it ought to be. And when he does it, you may not be doing what you like to be doing, but you got to do what God says. And children, I'm going to tell you something else. Just think about it. If you may have an illness right now, you may be praying about it and it gets worse. And you pray some more and it gets worse. Give it to the Lord. Give it to him. People look at you like you're nuts when you say that, and if you tell them you turn it over to Jesus. Yeah, well, yeah, I know I did it. Okay. But when you give it to him, God will take care of it. He'll heal you. And the two ways, you can be the healed on earth or you be healed in death. Because when we leave here as Christians, we're going to never be sick again. We're going to heaven. Too often we miss it a lot of times. And look what he said in verse 2. Which he had promised the poor by his time of the product of prophecies in the Holy Scriptures. What he's saying is, all the way through Scriptures, through the prophetic books, God was making promises about Jesus coming. He just kept on. And these years, he came. I don't know when Jesus is coming back, but I do know he is. Because that same God who promised him the first time has promised him the second time. I don't know when he's coming back. But I'll tell you something about it. I do know this. That when he comes back, all the world shall know him. He won't have to worry about finding a little place to stay. God, that is going. We're going to see him coming. We're going to see what he's doing. And I think about all kinds of things that happen. So many things that are happening now that don't happen too often. And some of them have never happened. But God's always trying to open our eyes. He's trying to get us to see that this is the way it really is. And you need to get close to him, and you need to let him put his loving arms around you and let you know how much he loves you because you belong to him. You need to call on him every day. Get on those knees if they'll take it. And call it. God, it's me. He didn't need you to tell him, but it's all right. You need to tell him. So you will know you did it. Lord, it's hurting worse than it has in a long time. Please just deliver me. Give me strength. Bless my children. Bless my brothers and sisters, uncles, aunts, cousins, whatever it is. Keep ten, give them to the Lord. Stop running your mouth on the cell phone so much and talk about them so somebody can tape it and play it back on you. And you can't say you didn't say it. What you need to do is turn it over.
Turn it over to Jesus. And when you turn it over to Jesus, watch things start changing. Watch him make it all right. He said, Ralph, what's all right? That's totally right. Right to the core. And you don't have to worry about it after that. God has taken care of it. I don't know about you, but we need to keep our hand in God's hand. We need to stand tall, and we need to tell those folk who are struggling, look, it doesn't have to be this way. I'm not telling you that you're struggling because you're having a bad time. I'm not telling you you're struggling because you did something that made you deserve it, because none of us, all of us, as Willie used to say, come from something. So all of us have made mistakes in life. But what we have to do, though, in the process, we've got to ask God's forgiveness. And when God forgives us, don't act like you just hustled somebody. Be grateful. Be grateful. Say, oh, God, thank you so much for what you did for me. Thank you, God, for lifting me up when I was down. Thank you, God, for giving me strength where I was weak. Thank you, God, for letting me realize what life is really all about. Thank you, God, for lifting me up in those times when I just realized that I can't handle what I'm in. Thank you for those times, Heavenly Father, when you do marvelous things in my life. And I look around and say, oh, Lord, oh, Lord, just bless me. Lift me up, Jesus. Bless me. Grant me that power. Grant me that peace that you have. Grant me that joy inside my soul. Please, Lord, in spite of everything that I face, let me understand that I am yours now. I was either yours or the devil's. Well, I've given him up, so I'm yours, Lord. And I thank you for it. I thank you, Heavenly Father, that that which is impossible becomes probable and possible. And all of a sudden, it's staring in the face saying, hi, thank God. I don't know about you, children, but I'm going to tell you something. It's a good feeling to know the Lord is taking care. I don't know about me. And sometimes folks say, well, I ain't never needed. Well, you will. Don't worry. It'll be that way. God takes care. That's what I love about that song, God will take care of. God will. Nobody else may even try, or they may. Have you ever been sick and you just got well quick? Yeah. Sometimes you can't believe it because you say, wait a minute. My stomach was hurting so bad. My chest was hurting. This and all. And there's always, you always have some good old friend who comes in and says, don't worry, it'll come back tonight and probably have cured you. You don't need to listen to them. Because they ain't Jesus. When you ask yourself, what do I do? God will show it to you. As we continue to look in this particular chapter, I think it runs around verse 19, a few verses around there. What he is saying, he's talking about how people who thought they were so smart were not. He was talking about how men were sleeping with men like men and women should, and women were sleeping with women and women same way. Children, it's not what society says. It's what God's word says. I know it's a very popular thing to say people need to get they from back in the day. I wish they could take that out of the whole dictionary, cartoon, or anything. I'm so sick of people trying to hide things from that was back then. Well, so was the resurrection. So was Jesus' birth. So was Egypt. So was Egypt walking through on the ground in the Red Sea. So was Israel doing that. What makes you think that changes anything? What did God assure us? That he does not change? He's who he is. And he's the same God that opened the Red Sea is the same God that will welcome you into heaven. Don't play games. Hold on. Sometimes folks say, well, I'm trying. No, just hold on. Look how desperate your situation is and hold on. Yeah. Hold on when you're lonely. Hold on when you're struggling. Hold on when it just doesn't seem like it's going to work. Just believe that God is going to make it work out. He's going to make it all right, isn't he? Yes, he is. Has he ever done it for you? You may have been in a rotten relationship with some jerk or jerkhead. And that's not the same, that's different. That God will take you out of. God is not going to put you in a mess. You put yourself in a mess. Ask the Lord. And if you're in here and you're unmarried and you're thinking about
get married, ask God who it should be. But I was going to ask one of my uncles or one of my aunts and my cousin brother. No. Ask God. God knows who he created you for. God knows who he created for you. You said, but it's tough, and I'm just, I don't know, I'm just, it bothers me. I don't know what to do. I just keep on seeing. I can't get this together. Ask God. And when God does it, that's your choice. God has given you that choice. You know, and God will bless you. Oh, he'll bless you. Amen. Somebody may say, I don't know why you married so-and-so, and then about 4 or 5 years later into the marriage, and things are just flying. They say, God, how you do that? Tell them, the Lord God told me. Nice. Ask God about everything you do in your life. Amen. Ask him and he'll show you. Ask him and he'll bless you. And when he does, conduct yourself accordingly. I know that's not popular. Satan's stuff is never unpopular with some folks. What we do is, but the thing is, hold your arms out and let the Lord hold you. And let him bless you. Oh Lord. Let him help you. And when he helps you, don't take a vow of secrecy. When God helps you, and someone says, how did you make the decision? God made the decision. You know, so I've seen sometimes people who are single trying to tell other people who are married how to stay married. You do so much about it, why ain't you married? I'm not trying to be facetious or anything, but there's something wrong in something with you or somebody that you're married to that you're not married now. But you say, was it a mistake? Yeah, that's right. But don't put them in the same thing. Pray for them. Ask them to pray for you. Say, I'm lonely. I wish I had somebody. Ask God. God will get. God loves marriage. Male and female. God loves it. And when God puts you with who he wants you to be with, there may be some ups and there may be some downs. But let me tell you something. One of these mornings, one of these mornings, when God comes to take you home, you're going to be going home out of that wonderful relationship. Don't worry about it. Don't find yourself trying to do something that you can't do. Call on him. Keep your hand there. Just say, oh God, please, I don't know what to do. He will do it every time. You're in college and you're trying to find the best class to take at this time. Ask God. I mean, you have advisors, there's no problem with that. But ask God in the end, God, which teacher would be best for me? Which class, which the setting of which class is best for me? And you go in there and you're just blown away because it's just fantastic. It's fun even almost. And you wonder, man, boy, the Lord said. Now a lot of folks, you tell them, well, you believe that stuff. Just smile. Just smile, because when you're in heaven on a golden street and their feet are touching the fire, they change their mind. But it's a little late there. Just smile. Do it God's way. Brothers, sisters, we are God's children. We are God's children. Not our own. We are God's children. And since we are God's children, let's ask Daddy first and foremost. Let's ask God. And when he tells you, then do it. And when you do it, if it's a challenge or two, he's going to help you get some spiritual growth in that challenge. But oh, let me tell you, but when the joy comes, Lord have mercy, when the joy comes, oh my. Be not dismayed. Whatever betides, may look like it'll never work. God will. God will take care. Beneath the wings of love, God will take care of. And I love the way the writer, from I love to see the face of the person writing. God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Through everything, oh, all the way, God will take care of you. Be not dismayed.
take care of me through every day. All the way he will take care of you. God will take care. Not saved this morning, come. Give your life to Jesus Christ. You drifted from him, come back to him. If you're his, it's yours. I can say, it felt great for you. Oh, yes, Jesus. Yes. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Oh, God. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. I'd like to ask you to stand. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, you will. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes. Yes. Sing, children, sing.
Master.
Oh, hallelujah.
The tempest
sing your song.
Is raging.
You want to get some courage right now?
The billows.
God's in charge.
Give me some.
Sing your song, child. Oh, yes.
The sky is overshadowed. Carest thou not that we all you gotta say is
there will be peace.
There will be peace.